Oh, I guess I can start all over now. Can you hear me?
I got you. What happened?
I opened up with my mic on mute. I did. Perfect. Okay, so I'll come back and say hello. You can see a little later on, this is all recording, so screenshots, and we're going to play some video. And kind of string some of this along. This is a ponder gander with your host, me, Vincent Easley, and Ben's along at the helm with me. This is the radio writing series. This is volume one and episode two of the Bundy Ranch trial and standoff. So we're at the trial stage right now. Come together to, we have to put it all together piece by piece. So we're going to take and cut a little bit out of in the middle. And today's title is, well, the standoff, what if Clive and Bundy is right? And it is standing matters, what's up? Closed to the public hearings, sealed documents, and sanctions. And we have some video to bring together in this timeline and see where the state has really come to oppress and why this is so important for everybody. It's not just about cows and in fact, it's not about cows at all. It's not about cliving. It's not about cows, but it is about control. We're going to take a further look at that. And I want to take a look at my controls here. Everything's running, seems to be. And my screen capture. I want to change to Chrome over here. That won't come in. Yeah, thank you, Grimner. I have to unmute to do this, right? Doing it again. But hey, Ben, how are you?
Doing well. Pleasure to be here.
I appreciate you. So you're going to be doing some stuff simultaneous right now. Are we streaming over to Sound Minds on a live video?
We're wrestling some technical issues over here on this end, so bear with me a little bit.
Okay. Well,
Yeah,
this
we
will.
should be up and going here in just a second.
Okay. Good. We'll wait for you to get that set and. Let me come back and look around over here. Let's pop around just a little bit. This is before we start in over there, I do want to start over here. So first of all, I'm going to say howdy. Well, I'm still waiting. Wait, we're waiting on Ben.
Go right ahead. Go right ahead.
Okay, are y'all ready?
We're give me just a second here. I'm making sure that we've got your screen going here, and we're going to get going
All
live
right, wait a minute.
here.
I want to get out. If you're doing screen capture, I don't know if you're seeing. I'm going to leave chat private. So I'm going to leave you guys out of here, out of chat. If you want to join the chat, come on along to reallibertymedia.com and click on the IRC over there, all that kind of stuff. If you're a client, if you know what it is, you'll know what I'm talking about. Otherwise, it's real simple. Just click in there. You can use an anonymous name and make something up. Be real cool and come along and take a ponder gander and let's see what's up. And so this is the other me, Vince Easley. It's a couple of them that I use for slaves. Here on Facebook, this is my carryover and my tag and my YouTube's come over here to Vince Easley, but I'm actually Vince Easley on Vincent Easley the Second's Facebook timeline. And here is the same thing of me, a ponder gander. Oh, that ain't me. That's another guy. That's a scaramouche, huh? Let's go look at this guy. Just so you know, I ain't hiding. This is my super secret identity. That's me. Free hugs, scaramouche. Capitanizani. Do you fantango? And yes, it is true. I come more to discover secrets, but more to trust than to suspect fitly. Nothing but words gratify me. And I'm from Scaria, a moosh. It's a fun place to be. Especially when you have to sneak up on these people over there on Twitter to block you. JJ McNabb and Kieron Suckling and what's his name? The Bundy sketch artist. And, MD Lauder. I think that's all. Yeah. Who else? I don't know. Don't care. Anyways, I'm gonna sneak up on him. Here's my friend Captain Carl, and he You've got a couple of arrests up there in Clark County, in Nevada, Las Vegas, and up in Mesquite. So in North Las Vegas, he got his case thrown out. They didn't want to take it to trial. He should probably go get this get the whole post here. Let's see what happens when we push that button. So we're going to take it all the way back to realliberty.org, and it's a social media site for people like me and you. So Carl Coney, he says he had his first of many to come right to travel without a driver's license and or vehicle registration. Some of the patties over in Thogbo have called out that the vehicle is registered. So it does say and or, so there's a that. And so the win in North Las Vegas today, that was a couple of days ago. The DA got a hold of his legal brief, he says, of dozens of top copies of American People wins in the federal and Supreme Court of the U.S. They saw a sanction, or sections 241 and 242, deprivation of rights under color of state statutes and codes. He goes on to say more, and I did not put that over in the post, but I'll bring that along. And further, we're going to be talking about another friend we have in common. The three of us spent time together, Captain Carl, myself, and Bran Thornton. And so to stand with Bran and the rocky road is ahead towards the end. We're going to talk about Rocky Hall and calling Bran Thornton a FBI agitator or foreman or provocateur or all of this. So I have some response to her on her video, and I'm going to go look at that. Like I say, that'll be on towards the end. Let's go back over here. Let's go back to from Capitani over to me, Vinny. That's RLM Radio on Twitter. And so this is the standoff. What if Clive and Bundy is right? In this section of the radio writing series, I'm looking at closed to the court public hearings, sealed documents, and sanctions. And that is not next, but right now on Real Liberty Media, RLM Radio. It's a Ponder Gather radio writing series. That's Fridays at noon Central, 1 p.m. Eastern Time. And let's scrolling along. Todd Ingle, that's one of our patriots locked up. Got a lot of time for spending 45 minutes at this so-called Bundy Ranch standoff. 45 minutes he stopped by, and what happened? Many, many years. Big shout-out. I'm going to be giving some more shout-outs at Readout News, Sherry Duvalli, great hero, and, true journalist, and somebody that inspirational for myself, and definitely somebody to look at in her writings if you want to find a good source for Western news and previously in all of this. Bundy Ranch. This is the Next News Network and the guy from Oath Keepers. So I had something to say about it. And for you Trump fans, I think probably I lost a couple of followers here, but to those that refuse to compromise in the name of border security, now that's what Trump says, press says bigly, that the government is here to help. And then there's what old Ben said about those who would give up essential liberty to purchase little temporary safety deserve neither liberty nor safety. I don't know, that's what he said. Thanks, Gary Grimner, thank you very much. He's done a lot of work here and putting these players on for the we'll have to try to get over and take a look at that set up. Reminding you to listen to Hal Anthony coming along Sundays, and this is your notice behind the woodshed. Come on along. Here it is, look. Perfect. Let's open it up and look, shall we? Thanks, Graham. And he's got everybody now set up with this new system right here. It looks real cool. Got a turntable. Fired it up. Yep. We've got the tires spinning. And there's the record. And that is the record right there. Setting a record is what I've been doing here. That's my intent. Been doing it for a while. I'm going to continue. And I just keep pegging away at these keys over here on this keyboard. And eventually, it'll all come together, I believe. All right. Let me go back to the Facebook over here. And I need to pop back and get here and scroll down. There's my notification anyways for the Facebook. I'm gonna scroll down. That will give you a preview of towards the end here. I'm gonna get into with Bran Thornton and Rocky Hall. And it was just a year and some days ago that Clive and Bundy come back into the world free man. And from the Bundy's miracles and mercies and miracles, and they gave thanks this day again and every day, I imagine. And you can see that there. Or you will be able to see it. You ain't hearing it or seeing it listening live right now. And as me, look, this is a page that vents easily at this worker, so I don't actually get around much over here to do anything, but better hit some likes along the way. This right here, there's a good man, old Greg. Freedom! Yeah. He took a sign home as a souvenir. Greg Whalen. And Brian Hyde is going to finish out some too at the towards the end of the broadcast. We're going to hear from Brian Hyde, and that'll almost finish the broadcast. Hey, Lyle. I don't know who that guy is on the camera. Now, I shared this from Love and Liberty, Brian Hyde. And inside this article, don't blame Mr. Rogers for the rise of entitlement culture, from Barry Brownstein, does having inherent value undermine our ability to take responsibility, or does it enhance our freedoms to live from our highest purposes and values? And inside this, I really see a very good example of this being a contrast in ideology that is pervasive in the underlying conflict of society and is exhibited in this Western land battles that is going on properly and is properly exampled in this debate of the that is known as the Bundy Ranch standoff. Thanks, Mr. Rogers. There's quite a history to that man right there. And here it is right here. That will round out the broadcast. I just saw just here a few days ago this video from Rocky Hall against Bran Thornton. And I'm going to out her as the provocateur that she is. I met her back in 2014. Bran Thornton and I are friends. I did stay with him in Vegas the last couple of months that I was there. We traveled to Denver. We went up to Salt Lake City and Sandy, and he and I and Captain Carl. I got to know Bran pretty well. Spent a couple of months there. I met his family, and he actually took me and his family. And great guy. And I'm here to stand with Bran to testify that about these lies against him, and I'm gonna come and look at that some more. A little later on. And there you go, Greg Whalen. I'll stand with y'all again. And he does hate to see this fighting, but it's being perpetrated, so I have to stand against it. So this right here saying redacted on Brand. Somebody tried to come along and say, see, he's an FBI informant. They redacted his name. But they were calling him something else. But I guess we should wait and hold that off. Towards the end there when we come to that section. Here it is. Wow, 700 days. And you know what? Let's look at this because if I can see the edit history here. View edit history. This is a little example of the radio writing. It's going to show it. Let's see how we do. Let's scroll down. And then see more. So what I ended up with then. Came back. I ran it through the pro writing A a couple of times, and you see where I got. I had two afters in there. There's something else I took out of there. But so it'll be a year ago tomorrow when Clive and Bundy came home after 700 days and several knocks from the federal criminal court's system of justice, minus a few teeth. This old cowboy hit the ground running. Well, it goes on to say a little bit more. You can see that when you come to the video. And there's that. Now, if you're not over here at realliberty.org, come on along. I invite you. Oh, hey, I'm not logged in. I'm not on Firefox. Let's see if it'll let me do this. No, not without too much work. So you won't be seeing Real Liberty this time. But it's pretty cool that you can, you don't have to be a member to get in to see the links. Actually, I can do it like this without logging in. I can just go click as anonymous anybody. Because, see, I'm not about hiding. Rocky. Brand, he ain't about hiding. People can call him nuts, too, but he'll still say what he thinks. Provocateur and an FBI agent, he's not. He and I were both called by this old boy down in Florida. Brand, you'll have to come in. I'll point you out over here and get you to come over and tell us that guy's name down there in Florida. Said, man, you was FBI when we were at the Bruce Doucette trial and staying with Kim, his wife. And anyways, that's a longer story. Come back to that another time. So here we go. You can come see it. I put this as the picture that'll show up at the with the YouTube link at the top of the blog when I push publish on it. And I did this here so I could use this picture right here and put it over into the blog also. And Brand Thornton says from Numbers 10:9, he's a shofar man, the guy that blows the horn. And in Numbers 10:9, it says, if you go to war in your land against the enemy that oppresses you, then you shall blow an alarm with the shofar. And that's him there. Now, here's some news. Jeanette Finicum was quietly married in a private end-of-year ceremony. And there's... from her legal battle update and new beginnings. There's more information there. And we did, Grimner came along and we did some tutorial here so far on BitChute. And it was an open shot video editorial, editor tutorial. Put those two words together. Hey, this was a pretty neat site I found, Old Time Radio link there. And man, there's a lot of stuff there. It's archives.org. /details/ old time radio. You'll see some of my studies over here. There's when justice goes wrong and how to make it right. This is a video in the Brady versus Maryland 1963 case. The United States Supreme Court held that defendants' due process rights preclude a prosecutor from suppressing material evidence favorable to the defendant. It goes on. That's what we saw with the Bundy USA versus Bundy et al. Inside, I have some comments, and then let's see, more. Yeah, they cut to a couple of places there, so you can go back and see that. Okay, there's more down there. There's just come on over. I'll put this in the blogcast or where you can come over and scroll down. there's more on how the criminal justice of just us or them works. So let's go over and go ahead and get this going. Let me take a look at my recorder. Yep, that's what we got going. And I'm going to mute up after a little intro to this. So at the we came up to a point where we was looking at a mistrial versus a dismissal, and whether it would be with or without prejudice. And this video is Roger Roots that interview. Let's see, that's second. First is we're starting off with the close of the public court hearing, sealed documents and sanctions. Bundy Ranch jury trial number 3, called a rally by John Lamb, and that is against the secret proceedings that had become all too familiar in Judge Gloria Navarro's courtroom at the Las Vegas Federal Courthouse. And let's go click this right here, open up to the video, and This is, we probably won't run this whole thing. But let me just turn it loose and let it run here a little bit.
Hey, live everybody on Facebook.
Hello, everybody on Facebook. Hello. Always everybody on Facebook, you're in the wrong place. You're not supposed to be at work and you're not supposed to be at Facebook. Don't pay, don't comply, and come to the courthouse and tell them all they need to be fired.
You heard that, right? So, Morgan Philpott has not been removed as Ammon Bundy's attorney. I lost my glasses somewhere. I think I know where I left them. Maybe. No. Nope, I've lost them. Oh, I found them. They're in my pocket. I thought they'd be on my head. Oh.
Good morning.
Good morning.
How are you today?
Good. Tell everybody about your project, who you are and where you at on your blog spot.
Well, my blog spot is iwearacowboyhat.com, which I don't have with me. And so it's a blog where I tell about the daily proceedings in the court, what's going on with you know, with the judge and with the lawyers. And
I heard you had a Bitcoin.
And I'm writing a book about this trial and about the stand down. In fact, it's about the BLM.
Well, you can buy them $20 at a time.
So, right, hopefully next year that book will be out.
And, look forward to it.
Pardon?
I say look forward to it.
Oh, thank you.
Thanks.
Appreciate it.
Appreciate it. Bye, Ammon. We'll see you later. Bye, Lisa. I'll send y'all pictures. Sana.
Thanks for being here, man.
I'm proud to be. I'm real proud. Thanks.
And that's you too.
Yep, that's Cindy Lake. Francis said, I think she's saying hello. She said, is that Cindy Lake, Francis?
Oh, hey, Fran. Yeah, it's Cindy Lake.
Haha.
I'll be your backdrop. I'll be your backdrop.
So, Morgan Philpott has not been removed. Judge Gloria Navarro was trying to sanction him. Can you imagine? It's really, hi, Francis. It's an atrocity what's going on in this court. It has been. Everything's been blown wide open. That note was released, that 18-page note. You know, they tried to play it down and call it a note. So he's, the guy's been same from the for a very long time. How Dan Love and his Rough Riders were.
You voted for Seal.
It's terrible.
You
ran over people. Actually, literally. And throw them on the ground, beat them, stomped and smashed their face in the ground till gravel stuck in their face. Yeah, they were having a big hoopla and laugh about that. Thugs. Who's the criminals? They've charged the Bundys and others with crimes that they're guilty of. And terrorists. It started weeks before. The whole assault. An army of 200 agents descended on the Virgin Valley. You know, on April the 12th, I was up on the stage and then with Ammon, and he was talking. He said he wasn't afraid anymore. The other day he was terrified. I'm sorry, let's listen to John.
The sealed hearing is totally over with this morning. Things went excellent today. The gist of this sealed hearing today was trying to put sanctions on one of the defense attorneys, Morgan Philpott. The prosecutors are scrambling down here to try to figure out how to stop what has been happening of this leaked information, all these discoveries that's been popping up from Pat Shea, Sherry Read Out News and stuff like that. They're trying to figure out who leaked that information. They're trying to sanction, Morgan Philpott for something he said in front of the jurors a couple of weeks ago. All of this, it didn't happen. Judge Gloria Navarro did not sanction him today. She just admonished him and told him, just not let this happen again. This kind of stuff has been happening all along, all the way from Oregon. And
hi, Deborah.
I talked to a couple people down here just briefly this morning, and things like what they did to Mumford, and they're still doing to Mumford, these sealed court hearings, this keeping this all secret away from the public, behind closed doors. This kind of stuff should be made public. It wouldn't have gone this far if we'd have known what this document that this whistleblower released here, actually probably months ago, but we just didn't find out about it until late November and just yesterday when it actually got totally exposed out there. But everything went good today. There's no sanctions on any of the attorneys. We're moving forward, hopefully with a full dismissal as early as next Tuesday or Wednesday. It hasn't been made public yet, so we don't know. There's a lot of documents that the judge has to go over. The late night motions that were filed yesterday by the prosecution trying to rebut all these Brady violations. So a lot of stuff has to be read yet. A lot of stuff has to be decided. It is not over at this point, but we're all in good spirits down here. It's looking great. We don't expect it to go past Wednesday. We expect Clive and Bundy to be released, and that's what we're going to still stand pray here.
Woo! Yes.
He should be released, and this case should be totally dismissed. We have really nothing else for you at this moment. That's all that happened down here. We're going to keep on our toes, waiting just in case any more big surprises happen in the next few days. But the Las Vegas Review-Journal is another big one. They filed some a suit here demanding that these sealed documents get released to them and to the public. So that hearing can be heard at any time, today, Monday, Tuesday. But so a lot of things are happening. It can happen at any moment. Things change quickly down here, as you're seeing. Every day something new is coming out. So we'll keep you updated. We will, throughout the day, throughout this weekend, if anything happens, you guys will be the first to know. We are here on the ground, and we are catching this as it happens. Again, thank you for joining us. Keep us in your prayers, and that we get a full dismissal. And God bless.
Okay, thank you, John Lamb. John and Kelly Sturrock gave a lot of great updates during the trial. Excellent updates, kept us very informed. Hey, Ben.
What you think about it, Vinny?
Yeah, how's it working over there for you? You got her streaming out?
Yes, sir. We are live streaming. We've got all links tied to realliberty.org.
All right. So. And realliberty.media.com, also the website. The realliberty.org, that's our attached along social media website over there. Better than Facebook. You don't have to worry about getting all them censors, I guess. So thanks, Chloe. I appreciate that. I opened up my other computer over here so I can watch chat and not have it while you're capturing that. So we'll stay over here in the Firefox. Now, I was talking about Roger Roots. Let's read a little bit here that's going to go to the blog. Failing again in the Nevada federal courthouse, Judge Gloria Navarro declares a mistrial in this latest round, the third attempt at a conviction. Misconduct by the prosecution, FBI, BLM, I should have added in there the U.S. Forest Service with Brady and Giglio violations in discovery obligations pale compared to the civil and criminal acts and vicious prosecution by the state. Shackled, contempt and cover-up, lies and suppression of evidence, hidden in sealed documents and behind closed doors, secreted court proceedings have bound the truth from being presented these past 2 years. It was really a lot they had to overcome. Ryan Bundy was arguably a leading force in this cohesive determination for justice, along with the unrivaled efforts from lawyers, legal aides, and many hands of difference, diligence, lending in behind the scenes. I tried to cut these down small where it was easier to just pack everything in. So if you have a trouble reading that small print, sorry about that. Hit expand, I guess. So January 8th, would hear motions from the defense team to dismiss charges with prejudice. And if not resolved, they had set February the 26th on the docket to reconvene, and that with a new case. In the courtroom, the defense, Cliven Bundy, Ryan Bundy, Ammon Bundy, Ryan Payne, Bob Whipple. These are the lawyers, Bob Whipple, Brenda Wexley, Dan Hill, Roger Roots, Larry Klayman, Masor Fletcher, Morgan Fieldpot, and Rick Coiber. Gloria Navarro in between. Yeah, right. Stephen Myrie, Nadia Ahmed, and Daniel Sheets. And they would, Myrie, the AUSA, he was replaced. But they certainly had interest in trying to bring these charges and not having Gloria Navarro dismiss them. But she did. Had no choice. This is a quote. And I take this from Roger Roots. He's a nationally recognized attorney, criminologist, constitutional scholar, author, civil liberties activist, and advocate for the rights of the disenfranchised. He promotes a freer, fairer, and a more just world. Never in American history has government had so much unchecked power to hurt people as it does now. Few lawyers are prepared to challenge the modern governmental leviathan. I view the struggle against government as a lawyer's highest duty. We're going to get Roger to quote that when I interrupt him a little bit, listen a little bit here in this video. If the rule of law means anything, it means that the government must lose at least some major cases. Yet the modern legal profession has mostly ceased being an obstacle to expansive and intrusive government. Sadly, most Americans. Oh, one sec. Okay. Could be a bit louder. Thanks, Dork Cakes. Not sure where to go with that right now. Maybe that was on the video. I hope this is okay. So I come back. Sadly, most Americans are left to fend for themselves when government targets them. Friends, employees, and associates abandon them. Even worse, most members of the modern legal profession view the state as a source of warmth and comfort, and most modern lawyers will never challenge the state. I am reminded of the legacy of Lord Camden, the great libertarian judge who presided over the British Court of Common Pleas throughout the 1760s. Lord Camden's far-reaching decisions and opinions paved the way for American founding fathers to draft and enact the Fourth Amendment and to enshrine principles of free speech and the right to jury trial in the Constitution and laws of the United States. The American founding generation revered Lord Camden. Camden, New Jersey, Camden Yards, where the Baltimore Orioles play baseball, and many other places were named for Lord Camden. If a similar libertarian judge were to rise in the judiciary today, he would live forever. Monuments would be built to honor him. But there are no Lord Camdens on the benches of American courts today. The vast majority of American judges fuel and empower expansive and intrusive government. Let's listen to Roger. We're gonna back up just a little bit. Get on this video. So here we go. Now I'm gonna need to go push buttons, I think. And I'll hit mute while this winds up.
Go. All right. Yeah. There's a little bit of confusion about the difference between a mistrial and dismissal. The judge today, Navarro, found grounds for a mistrial. Mistrial can mean that the indictment still exists, okay? The indictment hasn't gone away. And she did set new trial dates for potentially another trial. So they could potentially retry the same group with the same indictment. Dismissal means end of the indictment, okay? And without prejudice would mean they can go and bring up a new indictment. With prejudice means that it's over. They can't, under double jeopardy grounds, they can't really bring up a new indictment at all. In fact, the when double jeopardy attaches is when the jury is sworn in. The jury was sworn in, so double jeopardy would attach at this point, meaning that if the judge finds on, all the lawyers are going to respond by January 28th with briefs about whether or not this case should be dismissed with or without prejudice. Obviously, the defense will argue with prejudice that it's so willful, the Brady violations were so willful by the prosecution that it was really on the prosecution's fault for the mistrial, which means it will be with prejudice, and that will not just be a mistrial with prejudice. That would be, in my opinion, a dismissal of the case, and that would be with prejudice because the jury was sworn. So in the middle of a jury trial, there were these violations. The jury was sworn in, and the Fifth Amendment double jeopardy clause requires that no person shall be twice put in jeopardy, meaning that the case will be over if the judge declares dismissal with prejudice.
How that will that affect the next round and the previous round trials?
The next group of guys, the so-called Tier 2 group, they're free as far as I'm concerned. They're free on several arguments. Number one, speedy trial arguments. They've been demanding speedy trial, you know, for almost 2 years. They could get out. They could get the whole thing dismissed with regard to themselves on speedy trial grounds, in addition to these Brady violations. But in my opinion, the group that's in that next group of men to be tried are free, completely free.
And the previous guys?
These current set of guys are still, remember, Cliven's still in custody still locked up. They still are facing at least potential or conceptual retrial in February. But, you know, we're obviously going to push and we're going to the lawyers are going to argue that it should be dismissed with prejudice and it should be over completely.
Good. Thanks, Roger. Founder of Lysander University, Roger Roots, and quite a long list. You have a PhD. You're a lawyer and...
Lawyer and a doctor.
And a doctor. And your highest duty is, and I quoted you a little bit in shortening it all,
liberty.
My client is liberty. That's right. And your highest duty is to challenge governmental authority gone bad, the Leviathan, if I...
Every lawyer's highest duty.
Yeah. Thanks, Roger. Thanks, Linda.
That's the conviction factor. That was next in the playlist. That's on Real Liberty Media on the YouTube channel. YouTube.com/ Real Liberty Media. All together, one word. And that's all you got to do. Type that in and you'll come right on along to Real Liberty Media. Go to the playlist. Look for Bundy Ranch Standoff. I've got 61 videos there. Most of all that is original, but mine. Some shared work in there. Creative Commons and attributions. And y'all are welcome to use anything I got and give attribution. Unlike some people like the news up in Salt Lake City and others that, there's a list. Used my stuff and other people's stuff and gave them no accreditation for it. So here's the list of these videos. So I'm just letting them go into this video recording for downstream. There's my friend old Paul Bliss right there. And he come along with some attire on the sandy beaches of Hawaii. A tater tail. It's a little cowboy humor for the beaches of Hawaii. Several videos, and I reposted some from back in 2014. Cliven Bundy's colorized words in my response with Antonio Castellon. There he is right there. You can see racism, Cliven Bundy responds, and what about racism? That's, I believe, a part two that I've brought back over to Real Liberty Media from my YouTube channel, Vincent Easley. Just like that, youtube.com, Vincent Easley, with a forward slash in there. And there was Channel 3 opening day, interviewed me. Antonio didn't let him come out for some reason to the trial. Prisoner transport, convey with aerial recon. I'd approach this big old highway patrol lady and give her my notification and intent and identify myself. And Brian Hyde, who's next? He is an official representative for bringing the updates along at the Bundy Ranch trial. Let me go back over here into the blog. Ben, how's it going over there?
Everything's looking good. We've got all our links tied right back to you guys, so we can make sure we're covering them from all angles.
Good, good. So a guy opened my other computer over there, and there's the chat. Chloe's going to push her pencil and post something there a little bit later, I think. Over to the realliberty.org site, rlog. Well, now, what happened anyways? What occurred here to bring all this trial to bear anyways? Did a shoot to kill and cover up policy set the stage for the Bundy Ranch standoff? Well, mass graves of slaughtered cattle unearthed in Toco Wash after the bungled raid on the Bundy Ranch was abandoned by the Bureau of Land Management and the National Park Service. The Bureau of Land Management said that the illegal structures, that is, water tanks and corrals on the Bundy Ranch, had to be removed to restore the land to its natural state. I really laugh at that. They're wanting to kill animals. I thought they were wanting to preserve them. A little longer story than that. Now the Bureau of Land Management said that the illegal structures, the water tanks on the Bundy Ranch, had to be removed to restore the land to its natural state. William Lahunes reported that the court order justifying the BLM operation appears to give the agency the authority only to seize and impound the cattle. Bundy blames the BLM wranglers who also allegedly killed two prize bulls. Griff Jenkins reported on the record that an unknown number of cows were buried in a mass grave. We're going to put this video on right here. And I'm going to go check my view. Switch.
Fox News obtaining new video of the mess left behind after the standoff between federal agents and protesters at the Bundy Cattle Ranch in Nevada. William Lajeunesse is just back from the ranch. William?
Well, the root of the dispute, of course, is the desert tortoise. A federal court gave the BLM authority to seize and impound Bundy's cattle to protect the tortoise. But the order did not say the agency could, as this video shows, destroy his water tanks, water lines, and fences. Bundy also blames the BLM for allegedly killing two prize bulls.
If you notice, I'm inside this pen where that bull was shot. And if you look along the inside of this pen, there's nothing where this pen has been bent. If you look on the ground, the post is still in the same spot. It hasn't even moved. It's not like the bull was smashing this pen and trying to attack the people or anything. The pen is sitting here, hasn't moved. No damage whatsoever. Where was the danger in that bull?
BLM wranglers allegedly shot the bulls because they were dangerous and could gore their horses. Bundy's friends say that the white bull was shot five times.
Nowhere in the court order that I saw does it say that they can destroy infrastructure, destroy corrals, tanks, desert environment, shoot cattle.
Now, the BLM said this afternoon these are federal lands and they don't need permission to destroy illegal fences, water lines, etc., to restore the land to its natural state. But remember, Bundy doesn't even recognize federal authority. And the government says he owes some $640 million in damages, and if he failed to pay, they would sell his cattle. Only we discovered a big problem. No one in Nevada would touch Bundy's cattle for fear of being blacklisted.
The sale yards are very nervous about taking these, what has in the past been basically stolen cattle from the federal government.
Documents show BLM paid a Utah wrangler $966,000, almost $1 million, to collect Bundy's cattle, and reportedly $300,000 for a Utah auctioneer to sell them. What they didn't plan for is a letter from the governor of Utah saying that Bundy's cattle could not be shipped or sold in Utah. So, Megan, on Saturday, the BLM is stuck with cattle that it could not sell, despite already spending millions of dollars in an operation that didn't work. This is not over. The BLM says it will try to resolve the dispute administratively and judicially, though Bundy does not recognize their rights and remains in violation, as you know, of multiple court orders. Back to you.
William, thank you. Well, new reaction tonight to the Bundy Ranch showdown, as critics suggest the federal response in Nevada was a case of overkill. And they say this is part of a larger pattern.
They can throw an army of men around there, literally, with sniper rifles, on guys just like you are, on people just like you are. Someday, they're going to throw that army of men around you.
Today is the greatest day in my lifetime. I've lived 65 years. Government just keep taking more and more, more federal government. Today, that's for the free men of America right there, for them soldiers that died and fought for it.
This right here is the best thing I've seen, the people taking their country back.
Judge Andrew Napolitano is Fox News' senior judicial analyst and with me now, taking the country back. And we've heard so much about how the Bundys did not have the law on their side. They were trying to stand up for a principle. But more and more in the days after this, Judge, people are talking about how it got that far. And if you look deep into this ranching dispute, what the ranchers will tell you is this was the straw that broke the camel's back, that they feel this has been a culture of intimidation. And in fact, there was a piece in the Washington Times just today that used that term, culture of intimidation, seen in the standoff. My question to you is that valid?
Well, the criticism is valid. It is a culture of intimidation. It's the federal government using grossly excessive force in order to resolve a dispute that you and I as lawyers know and people watching us now should understand can be resolved by filing some pieces of paper in a courthouse. Instead of filing some pieces of paper in a courthouse called a lien, the government says that it owes him money and a court order validated that, you file the lien on the property. And when he passes away, the government gets to collect. When he sells the property, the government gets to collect. One of those events must eventually happen, and the government can certainly exist until the money passes to it. Mm-hmm. Instead, they are showing up with an army, pointing M16s not only at Mr. Bundy and his family members, but at his friends, at people there to protest, to exercise the First Amendment rights, at Fox News, and at other news entities there trying to take pictures of them. That's what made this so hair-trigger-like, is the gross, unacceptable, unlawful accumulation of firepower there in order to enforce a judicial decree.
It's not the first time we've seen this. I mean, Fox News covered the raid on the Gibson guitar facilities in Tennessee, where we had agents armed with semi-automatic weapons, bulletproof vests, storming in over a piece of illegal wood that Gibson was using it in its guitars. They were criticized for their behavior on a family-owned mining operation in Alaska for heavily armed federal agents raiding that. We've seen some heavy-handed tactics, you know, in fact, in terms of these raids, and then we've seen it, you know, at a more broad level in terms of the IRS, the DOJ going after reporters, the NSA spying on us. I mean, it's big government run amok in the eyes of many.
It is the federal government thinking it is immune from the laws of the land, the laws of civility that govern the rest of us, even basic constitutional principles. There's a vast disconnect, not only between the federal government and people like Mr. Bundy. Remember, the government is the servant, not the master. That's in the Constitution on the Declaration of Independence. That's not a political statement. That's a value judgment in the American system. But the federal government believes, look, it is boasting about the fact that it has destroyed his property. Mm-hmm. The government is subject to the laws like everyone else. They destroy his property, they have to pay for it. But yet they think they can be a law unto themselves. That's why this particular case is now ground zero, Megan, for the average American who expects the government to be the servant and the federal government that thinks it can push the average American around.
But let me step back a notch, because he did not have the law on his side, Clive and Bundy.
That's right.
He had lost twice in a court of law, and what binds us together if not the rule of law? So where did the feds go wrong having the law on their side?
That's a great question. The feds blew this. They had a court order from the federal judge who issued a decree against Bundy. The Circuit Court of Appeals upheld that order. If the federal government had done this right, none of this would have happened. But they used such excessive force, such unlawful behavior, so much destruction of his property, that now the tide has turned against them. Public opinion is clearly against them. Mm-hmm. They had to back down because their behavior was indefensible at the scene. They were saying you can't even protest unless you go 3 miles away from here and stand inside a piece of tape.
Right.
So when the government loses control of the situation because of its own heavy-handedness, it's going to cause whatever court will look at this again, and you know it's going to go back to court to look at it very differently, and the government now has the losing hand.
Okay, thanks for everybody that was all part of that video. I think a lot of that can be traced back probably to Pete Santilli. And I would say probably his video is what is responsible for so many people having been able to respond. Well, this would have been a whole different story. Now, if it had gone like most had gone, then the cows would have been gone, or Clive and Bundy and many of his family would have been gone, and that's for certain. Now, let's see. I close it out. And this link right here for this video, this actually goes to source. And I was looking to go to, it's on a Facebook page. Matt Shea and Sherry Duvalli, she from Readout News, so this is her original work. Representative Matt Shea, he's up around the Spokane, Washington area. I was up there, and I didn't even happen to know who he was at the time. So anyways, regarding Dan Love and his alleged kill list, the whistleblower's letter is read. And we're going to listen to him do that. We do not, we do not know where this information has come from or how the email was obtained, but we are always thankful when the truth is told. Many people had reached out to the Nevada Attorney General Laxalt when we heard these allegations, and instead of being looked into, we were told to call Washington, D.C. because it was outside of his jurisdiction. Thank you, Matt Shea, for doing what the Nevada representative would not do. Thank you for investigating this matter and finding some truth for us. Thank you, Readout News, for being there for this breaking news. And read out your news. Read the rest at Readout. That's on Twitter. You can find them. Facebook, readoutnews.com. Thank you, Sherry Duvalli. And like I said many times before, you're a hero. Great inspiration. And you show how a normal person can step up and be the press and not be the sold out mainstream media. Now this, I know I copied the actual video instead of where it was at on the page of well, it's going to give it to me right place anyways, I do believe. Hold on a sec. And yeah, Bundy News and Freedom Watchers.
Okay, everybody,
let's
try
listen
this
in.
Please give me a thumbs up if you can see me, and give me a heart if you can hear me. We getting any thumbs up or anybody watching yet? Thumbs up if you can see me, and a heart if you can hear me. Awesome. Hello, everyone. This is Sherry Duvalli with Readout News. We are live from Spokane Valley, Washington. We're in the office of Washington State Representative Matt Shea, who is here to give us a special report on some very breaking news that will affect every American in this country.
Sherry, thank you for having me on. I appreciate it, and I appreciate everything you guys are doing with Readout News. You've been doing a wonderful job covering the trial down in Nevada. I would like to first start some of the things I'm going to be talking about today. Extremely serious, and I don't want to be overly dramatic, but I think you'll see why here in a second. I'm about to say what I'm about to say.
Okay, let me butt in here. Let me get some response here. That may be too low of an audio to go through here. Can anybody over there looking over towards the chat? Somebody give me a little feedback on this. And in the meantime, let me just go back to the video. May need to, I don't know. Okay.
Never had in my entire life ever an inclination to commit suicide. I have never in my entire life taken inappropriate pictures and stored them on my computer. In fact, I could have my computer forensically searched for such images. And generally speaking, I love my wife dearly, and we have a wonderful and happy
marriage. Okay. So well, this is not going to give us enough audio to play, but it is in the, it will be there described in the links. So go listen to this, and this is a letter from Wooten, the whistleblower. This here, I believe, is when he came forward is what really put a stopper in the whole deal. Just a second. Sounds like a bad chord. Thanks, Cooper. This put a stop to it. They had these sealed hearings. This is what it's the broadcast being titled. There's no telling where it would have went had Wooten not come forward. And he kept trying to come forward with this. And I'll have to just let you come along, and you'll have to go in and listen to that right there. So if you're over on the YouTube, we'll put some links in the description when it's all done. Standard matters, what's up? Indeed. And closed to the public court hearing, sealed documents and sanctions. And that's what the Bundys et al. Were up against. Now, this video, I had the privilege and honor of being behind the lens for Brian Hyde in Love and Liberty. Dismissed. We're gonna skip right on along here. Fast forward. Dismissed. Federal jurors showed up to court anyways. The Bundy Ranch standoff. Judge Gloria Navarro dismisses the indictment with prejudice for Cliven, Ammon, Ryan Bundy, and Ryan Payne. This trial is over. Let's take a listen. Ruh-roh. Hey, it's you. We have the original too over on Facebook, so I need to get that. But here, hey, look.
I'll just tell you right up front, the decision that we had hoped for today was given, and that is a dismissal with prejudice.
Here we go.
So this means that Cliven Bundy is coming home today. This means that Ryan and Ammon Bundy are free men today. Unfortunately, Ryan Payne still has some outstanding business that is being faced up in Oregon, and per Judge Anna Brown up in Oregon, he will have to return there to be held accountable for that. But what an incredible morning. And, you know, it probably doesn't show now, but I'm one of many people who has spent probably the last 20 to 30 minutes wiping tears of gratitude away. What just an incredible morning. Court started, or was supposed to start right about 9 o'clock. It runs a little bit late sometimes. But there were people here as early as 7:15 this morning waiting for a chance to get into the courtroom. And obviously not everybody was able to make it into the courtroom. We counted 96 people that actually were able to be seated as spectators. There were probably at least another 50 that were required to wait outside. Looking back at one side of the spectators gallery, it looked like it was almost entirely the Bundy family members. And one of the neatest parts of this morning was among the people who were waiting in line, I recognized about a half dozen jurors. Yes, the jurors from this trial that was declared a mistrial showed up to be here in support. And they did this on their own. This was on their own dime. It was on their own time. Nobody told them that they had to be here. But I'll let you draw whatever conclusions that is. Why would jurors who are not being ordered to report for jury duty show up for a hearing such as this. I can only speculate that something about this trial touched their hearts. And in talking with those jurors, you know, they were saying, we wouldn't want to miss this. So, powerful stuff going on. I'll just give you a very quick recounting here of some of the things that the judge went over. I'm going to tell you this. Steve Myrie was in attendance. There was speculation as to whether he would be there. He and Mr. Sheese and Ms. Ahmed were also in the courtroom. This was not a pleasant day for them. I sat and watched, and I could see Myrie's ears in the back of his neck getting redder and redder as the judge described her ruling and why she spelled out, of course, why she was ruling the way that she was. These are some of the words that she used. This will give you an indication why she felt the right thing to do was to dismiss this with prejudice. She used words like especially egregious, grossly shocking behavior, referring to the prosecution, and specifically referring to not only the fact that evidence was withheld, but the way that evidence was withheld, and the fact that it was withheld and stonewalled, and they abdicated responsibility by saying, well, the FBI needs to supply us with these things. She used words like flagrant prosecutorial misconduct, reckless disregard, willfully failing to produce Brady material. And she spelled it out chapter and verse at which point each of these violations of due process rose to the level where the only fair recourse was not to have another trial, which was what the government had suggested in its motion filed December 29th, but actually to dismiss this with prejudice because it involved a very serious constitutional violation. There's a need to preserve judicial integrity, and there's also the need to deter future misconduct on the part of the government. So the bottom line is this. I spoke to Carol Bundy yesterday on my way to Vegas. I stopped in at Bundy Ranch and talked with her. And of course, we asked, what are you thinking? What do you think is going to happen? And to me, one of the neatest signs of faith that I have ever seen was she says, well, I'm going to be down there tomorrow, and I'm bringing Cliven's cowboy hat in the car. And I thought, all right, that's like a person who's praying for a drought to end, bringing an umbrella with them, you know, just in case. As we left the courtroom today, I heard many, many people whisper, praise God or thank God for this. And I want to be very clear. The credit for this, you know, by the Bundys and by so many of their supporters is given to the Almighty. And there were a lot of great people all playing their role to come here and to help get the word out. There's a part of me wants to believe that fire truck is actually a celebratory thing. Maybe I'm grasping. I don't know. But I want you to know the faith that people had going into the courtroom today that the right thing was going to happen was not in vain. And what an honor to be a part of this and to be able to share this with you. I hope this makes your day the way that it has made so many of our days here. We'll see if we can grab some interviews with members of the Bundy family.
It's clean. Here comes the rain.
As we could, and the rain
it's
starting.
It's washing it away.
So please share this widely. Thank you for following us on Who's Next. We will have more updates coming up. Thank you.
Thank you, Brian Hyde. Let me stop this. Well, I'll just let it roll right in there just for a quick second. Say, not guilty, Bundy Ranch. That's the next one in the playlist I've got up on my bit shoot. We also have a bit shoot.
Well, I hope you can.
And there's a little extra I threw in. Yeah, I'll be seeing this. Now, what I want to do before I get out of here is, bear with me a minute. How you been?
What you think about it, Vinny?
What are you thinking? I'm gonna look here, do a search. So, give me some words.
Well, I think the boot of tyranny definitely needs to get off our throat, and one way or another. If we don't speak up about how bad it's getting, as we know that the technocratic tyranny is not much better, and if we don't address these issues pretty quick by basically saying, hey, it'd be nice if you'd follow the law, who's to mention anything about oaths or duties or, you know, hey, the taxpayers basically having fraud committed against them and many other. I guess it would be, oh, I don't know, crimes and, geez, I mean, where do we go with this? I mean, we can take this on several different levels.
Well, definitely tyranny. So I'm over here, the Las Vegas Review Journal, and I'm going to eventually get here to a spot, and I'm gonna backtrail the events through the timeline. Whoops. Okay. And I think Washington Post, I'm going to have to renew my next time I go there. And I'm going to have to also get it here. Okay, there you go. Come on. The Review Journal, I'm going to have to get my subscription updated there as well. Let's see. I'm going to go down to the bottom and jump over. Well, to get the almost even the full timeline here. But look how many pages we've got here. 28 pages. I probably don't need to go where I was actually at earlier, which is, I think, 8 pages in. And that's the about the time all the trials are starting. The first round of trials. Where are we at? November 2017. Let's go ahead and jump on over to page 5 of this. So a lot of respect to the Review Journal. They did some tremendous journalism, true journalism then. And like a fellow I met, he happened to work with my brother-in-law some years back at the Review Journal. They're there to report. And they also did like filed suits to make them get them to open up some ceilings and this and that, sealed documents and whatnot. I'm going to start at 5. Where are we at? May. So we've already had some trials, May 15th in 2017. And we'll jump in there. You can go look for yourself here at reviewjournal.com/news/Bundy/ No. The one deal. BLM. Anyways, you can find that. Sorry about that. I'll put this into the blog. Where am I at? No retrial planned for two Bunky Real standoff defendants, and that's May 17th. And I want to scroll up. Now here's Jerry DeLimas, first prison term imposed in Bunkerville standoff case, and the judge gave him a little bit of extra time just because she thought she should. But, that's Jerry DeLimas, and that's May 31st of 2017. Now we see where, what was his name, this FBI agent in in line about shooting Lavoie Finicum, Astorita, that's his name, Astorita. And he got off on that. A lot of cover-up involved in that. Jury selection to start for Bundy Ranch standoff retrial. So they ended at a mistrial. They tried him again, and then Scott Drexler and Eric Parker, they drugged them along, was going to add them into. So that was, they had three tiers. That was the second tier they started with. Then Cliven and his sons and Ryan Payne come along to the first tier in the second round of trials, which second round plus the retrials and their big, whole big circus. Anyway, so then those guys took some misdemeanors, other people convicted, Greg Burleson and Todd Engel. There's other people there that have taken pleas and wonder, you know, with all this dirty dealings from the prosecution, should they not be thrown out as well. What we want to get to is the timeline of the Bundy Ranch trial, and looks like this is getting pretty close at 3. We'll start here. At some point. Well, so this is the wind-up before the trial gets going. We're in September. Now, October the 3rd, this is 3 days after the 1 October event, as it's been dubbed, in the many, many people that were killed there in Las Vegas on October 1st, 2017. And Ryan Payne had wanted the trials postponed. I got interviewed there at Channel 3 in my interjection on that. So the Judge Navarro does delay the trial, and that's from October 7th. October 23rd is when it comes along that Eric and Parker and Scott took those lesser pleas. There was some shenanigans going on in there. That's a lot longer story to look at also, how they were trying to manipulate that. Well, saying one could take a misdemeanor, but somebody had to take a felony. A lot more to that story, a story there. Andrea Parker, Eric's wife, had done such a job of covering and live streaming from the court. So you can find more information than probably. Boy, it'd take a while, because she was thorough. If you want to know the alls of it, you go to Andre, you go to John Lamb and Kelly Stewart and David Fleeman, and there's others that were live streaming updates. Of course, Brian Hyde, list is long. Let's see here. Bundy trial on hold while the judge weighs surveillance. This is November 7th. Wait a minute. Let me back up a little bit. October 28th, the Las Vegas trial to begin for Clive and Bundy and Sons. November the 3rd, jurors to hear from Bundy family lawyers about Standoff. November the 7th, Bundy trial on hold while Las Vegas judge weighs surveillance. So a lot of this exculpatory evidence, this is when Ryan Bundy had tried to file all this stuff, and he had said at one point, you know, I can't keep up with this back and forth. I expect my motions be taken serious. And this is this cat and mouse game that the prosecution was playing. Myrie and Ahmed and Sheese, some dirty dealing. So motion to dismiss federal case comes November 8th, and that was denied. I think I started at 3, so we'll go back to the bottom here and back up to 2. Now, looky here. Looky here. The desert tortoise faces uncertain future amid Bundy conflict. Well, I can tell you that the tortoise has not been harmed by anybody except for these false front operations like the Center for Biological Diversity. That's going to be a big one to talk about. I've talked about it quite a bit. We're going to bring all that together too. All right, let's get on down here. And I had to turn off ad blocker for DRJ and do for some sites. All right. Now, Clive and Bundy, he says, no, sir. No, sir. No surrender. No terms. He rejects the opportunity to be released November 29th. Supporters greet Ammon Bundy in Las Vegas after his release November 30th. And I got quoted by it's NPR, I guess. No, PBS. And my predictions that the rest of the folks in there would be soon be released as well. And that was a prediction that did come true. There you go. Judge releases four more Bunkerville standoff defendants. December the 4th, Las Vegas judge hits at mistrial in Bunkerville standoff case December the 11th. Now we're getting back into the timeline where we started out at December 11th, and more there. Actually, and at the same time when Ryan got out, I got the first his first interview. Me and some gals from Francais over there. I never could find where their work was published at, but somewhere. And here we go. The Review Journal, which they really helped steer for truth and justice in this case. Tremendous shout out to the RJ, and that they asked judge to unseal Bundy docs in hearings. That is December the 13th. On the 15th of December 2017, here we go. Memo alleges government misconduct in Bunkerville standoff case. Wooten. Mistrial. See, this is before the dismissal. Mistrial was declared December the 20th, the 2017, in the Bundy trial. It is it's over in over. I'm sorry, it's over withheld evidence. Yep. Good old my Myrie, don't ask, don't tell. I'm not making that up. I'm quoting that. Bundy mistrial highlights why right distrusts the feds. And so they're calling the Bundys right on the right side. Right? Are they right? Well, sure they're right. Absolutely. That was January 5th of 2018. January 3rd. Judge in Oregon standoff sanctions defendants for the Bundy, for visiting the Bundys. A couple of fellas stopped by to say howdy and have her picture took. And that did not go so well. January 8th is when Judge Gloria Navarro dismisses the case against Clive and Bundy and two sons and also Brian Payne. Yeah, that they didn't want any more evidence to come out, and that's for certain. It was a big cover-up, shoot to kill and cover-up. Go through and look at the videos. I've got that one in there and be in this blog. Are you going to get over to one? There you go. So go check out the RJ in their coverage and in the upcoming, I want to get Oregon, the Oregonian, and Maxine Bernstein's posting of that, and best in mainstream for her, for bringing all the trial proceedings inside and all the lingo that you need to know to be able to get along through there and write it. So maybe I've got some of my own. I got a few notebooks. That's another thing to come, is to be able to sort through all that. Okay, so here it is. And this brings us up into last fall, the FBI agent, he was not found. That's Astoria. He was found not guilty. He got off on that. August the 9th is when, we've already read that. Yeah, here we go. This would be Todd Engel, got 14 years, and he was there for only 45 minutes, stopped off 45 minutes. Judge rejects prosecutor's bid to reopen the Bundy criminal case. So the prosecution wanted to say, no, that's not fair. You've got to let us prosecute, convict. There's the rest. You can be looking in the video of this. Now, I'm going to wrap up today. In this stand for the brand on the rocky road. We're going to look at the post first of all. I've got some words for you, Rocky Hall. drink of water for a day. Yum, yum. So I just seen this video here, January the 7th. I guess it's a few days old at that time. It's from Rocky Hall against Fran Thornton. And here's one we'll get her, put her out just a little bit. Now, not so bad as any kind of violation. Well, wait, we'll look at what she had to say to me over in her video, but we'll come to that. Now, Brandon and I are friends, and I'm here to stand testimony for him. I stayed with him there in Vegas. Got to know him pretty good. I was talking earlier about it. I read all this earlier. But let me tell you that Brands is a straight-up guy. He's not trying to get around and hide anything. And that's for certain. Yeah. Now, I want to go look at Rocky. Let's go look at her video. I don't know. I'll give answer to her. Don't even want to listen to you, Rocky. All I can say is, we'll skim through here. Wait a minute. Let me go make sure we're looking what we're looking at here. Yeah, that'll be fine. I want to look at the whole thing. And let's see. Where does she get old? Close up. Slow motion, you know. And we'll go back and we'll see what Brand. See, now I talked to Brand even way before this. When I was staying with him, he was telling me about his encounter in all of this up in here. Now, where is he at? Can we get the close up? Wait, here we go. All right. Let's let it play here just a little bit. Get to it. Come on. Now these are accusations. What? Do you see that? All right. So out of all of that, this is what she has. Bran Thornton. A Bundy supporter, a Fed agitator, ? And calls this news and politics. That's what Rocky Hall calls it right there. Brand Thornton is caught assaulting a BLM agent. No repercussions. We'll go back and I'll show you what Brand said. Like I said, how many months ago, golly, does time fly? Like when I was in Vegas. Now, he was telling me about his encounter here. So, way ahead of you. Miss Rocky Hall. And here it is. I responded to her on her video. And a couple of days later, she come back to me with her response. So, I tell her, yeah. Do you remember the video I took of you that I didn't publish back in 2014? And I'm on to you. I know your game. And I have some other interjection to add on to this, but I'm not going to put it there now. We'll save that because we're going to want to have to look a little bit more closer. But I see you're in the background with some other people as the director of videos. And so you claim that you didn't make this video. You shared this video. Where's your attribution at, first of all? Where'd it come from? You can't call this news and politics, and you have not sourced. You have no credibility. Now, what about this video that I've been publishing you? And the difference between you and the difference between Brand. Brand's open and forthright, not trying to hide nothing and anything about what he is. Now, I'm not going to publish this video that I took of you, and because I told you, and oh, I guess you obviously don't remember. You don't remember me interviewing you in Thomas Lockevar Stewart's motorhome. Now, what you did, I could slow down, and I'm just going to only describe your motions. You're shaking your head no and mouthing the word no, 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 waving your hand left and right to side to side. Okay, so you know what? No, I didn't publish it. But what could be implied with that? I could take that clip right there and make some little pretty little thing like you've got up here, whoever made it. We don't know who made it. And then you get all these people coming along, assuming this to be fact when it's just a bunch of, it's bull, cockamamie bull. And you're responsible for it. You say you didn't make it. Yeah, well, you've got it up there with your name on it. Now, Rhodes and the Oath Keepers. Now, when we met last time, do you remember the last time we met up in Sandy, Utah? I wonder, do you? Well, you came out to me that time because here I am wearing an Oath Keeper shirt. And you're, hey, what chapter are you in? It's like I was expecting, or should have probably expected, a secret handshake or something. Rhodes, what about him? He's got some blurs on him, doesn't he? Again, more of a longer story. So, you're a provocateur. You're trying to stir something up here. What? And you're involved in other stuff, remember? Yes, you are. Won't you tell us? Won't you be honest and forthright? Snakes. That's right. There were plenty of snakes there. I'm going to assure you for sure. Sojourner, there were tons. Lots of infiltrators going on there. And here's your exposing lunacy. Brand Thornton also believes the earth is flat and thinks that Pizzagate is the Pizzagate hoax is real. Says he, calls him a nut job. Nut job. Now, Rocky, she comes along and gives everybody hearts. Ah, she even gave me a heart. Did you see that? Look, hearted it up and a thumbs up. Well, let's just give it a thumbs up. Thank you very much. And there's a notification someone just liked. That's on you, Rocky. All right. So we're going to run this on down to the end, I do believe. Hey, there's the duck hunt over in the chat room at reallibertymedia.com. Chloe caught her a duck, got another friend. She missed her first try. How many ducks you got? 86? You need more ducks. It's a fun little game. Oh, I had found it. I wish I'd left that open. There's a little thing I want to do about ducks and duck hunting. Kind of a funny little scenario, set of events that all bring it together of why there's a duck hunt going on in the Real Liberty Media chat. All right. Ben?
Yes, sir.
What
can I do
think?
For you?
You think we've run through here?
I think we've definitely covered a good handful here to say that we've got all the links and everything tied in. We've got everything going live. We've got all covered on this end, it looks like.
Good, good. All right. I'm going to ask Grimner to come over to me in a minute and make sure I wrap this end up right. So this has been the second part of Chapter 1. It's building the series outline. There's going to be a lot to it. I think I'm going to take all of my proposed 13 and a half parts to just for the trial itself. And I'll be adding in a little bit of these, what would have been other chapters as sections and add-ons. So it'll be a lot longer building the whole book. So this is a long bit of fun here, and maybe not for everybody to stand in and listen along, but I'm going to try to bring every bit of information together at available and then squish it all down into a little 13-page pamphlet. But we've got to get through all the grammar and the logic to get to the rhetoric, don't we? So let's try to do all that first. And I've been your host, and we've got Ben over here that's we're stumbling through this and seeing what we're putting together. So I intend to enhance this as we go along, and got some more to come along next Friday. And I've been standing in the gap, connecting voices and considering perspective, broadcasting what matters worldwide. This 13 and a half part series airs Friday at noon Central, 1 p.m. Eastern, on Real Liberty Media Radio, RLM Radio, to think and reason, raising expectations through thought-provoking episodes. RealLibertyMedia.com. There's more links in there. There's some Twitter locations for me and my Ponder Gander and RLM Radio and our bar man that works so hard at keeping things going. Freedom's Network, and don't forget Behind the Woodshed, where some lessons are learned. Yes, what matters a Ponder Gander, and that's me right here on Real Liberty Media. Check there at the bottom of this blog. You'll see that where you can just click on links. The Bundy Ranch playlist there on YouTube. Under Section 107 of the Copyright Act of 1976, allowance is made for fair use for purpose such as criticism, comment, news reporting, teaching, scholarship, and research. Now, you just figure where all that ties in at. And don't forget that. Add attributions. And as all this here will be all connected in. And you can track it all down yourself. What do you think, Ben? Have we left a good trail a little bit here?
I think we've got a trail for them to follow, that the breadcrumbs and the pile is getting bigger.
All right. So what I can do here is stop recording, and we'll see you next week. And come on along a little later. I think Grammy Mary's going to be back in the rocking chair blasting off if she's got her voice back. That's at 6 Central Time, and Grammy comes along at 10 p.m. with the Moose Girl on the Freakers Ball, y'all. And tomorrow, come along with the Flasheroo, and I believe that's at by 1 or 2, or 12 or 1. Pick your time slot there, Eastern or Central, for the Dork Table. Sunday, we play trivia in the chat, and Grimner has some blues playing in the background. It's some nice time to hang out and test your mind against the other trivia players. Thanks, Kate. Then, so that goes on, let's see, about from noon Eastern till 3 o'clock, sometimes start a little bit earlier. Hal Anthony is at 3 p.m. Eastern behind the woodshed, and that's the most important 2 hours that you could spend every week for those lessons from Hal Anthony. So come on along. Now, Mondays is we've got 7 Eastern Grim Leftovers. Tuesday is Flasheroony, contrasting the occupation with me sometimes in a perfect world. Wednesday's back to Grammy, and Thursday's back to the Flash with 20% off. It's a discount radio broadcast, all you can eat, baby. We're going to say thank you, everybody over there in the chat room, and I appreciate you inputting, and me trying to keep up Sound's minds is been a big help. Thank you very much. We'll call you next time.